the narration, through the ministry of the children as they yield themselves to you. Thank you, Lord, that you haven't left us alone, but you've given us your Spirit to comfort us and to strengthen us, especially in the day in which we live. Lord, how thankful we are that we can still share the truth with people. And we don't take that for granted. We know that it is an ensign of your mercy. We pray, Lord, that it would continue to be that way in our country, and that we would have continued opportunity with children through the school and through our church here. And Lord, even through the churches that are represented here. We pray for your mercy and grace in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God,
that you present your bodies a living sacrifice,
wholly acceptable to God,
which is your reasonable service.
1 Corinthians 15:58.
Therefore,
my beloved brethren, be steadfast,
immovable,
always abiding in the work of the Lord,
knowing that your labor is not vain in the Lord.
I shall not want.
He makes me lie down in green pastures.
He leads me beside the still waters.
He restores my soul.
He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake.
Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death,
I will feel no evil,
for you are with me.
Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies.
You anoint my head with oil.
My cup runs over.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me
all the days of my life.
And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Thank you. the eternal, splendid name,
that the whole heavenly army fears, that shakes the wide creation's frame,
and Satan trembles when he hears,
tell how he shows his smiling face,
and clothes all heaven in bright array,
triumph and joy run through the place,
and songs eternal as the day,
proclaim his wonders from the skies,
let every distant nation hear,
and while he sound his lofty praise,
let humble mortals bow in fear.
Sun and moon declare his glory, praise him all the stars of light. Praise his name with praise unending, for his name alone is great. Over heaven, earth exalted, praise the Lord and King we say.
Hills and mountains, praise your maker, praise him all the flocks and herds.
Sees at all that they contain. Hallelujah, praise Jehovah. Hallelujah. To the Lord and tell his glory. Oh, did not your voices raise? God has greatly blessed his people. All his people sing his praise. Chosen of the Lord and precious, thankful hallelujahs raise. Hallelujah, praise Jehovah. Hallelujah, sing his praise. Praise the Lord and tell his glory, thankful hallelujahs praise.
This is the opportunity that we have for an offering. Now, during our spring program, typically we have something special that we use the offering for. And this year, we have a lot planned for the summer. And Lord willing, our goal is to start our renovation of our modulars that are out here. And that would include both the exterior and the interior of the modulars. And we're beginning with the one that is immediately across from us right now. And Lord willing, we may be able to go beyond that. But a lot has to do with money, and we are trusting that the Lord will continue to provide for us here. But the modulars do need some serious renovation, and we need to make sure that we provide a good classroom experience for our students. So I would ask that you would give, and you give liberally to meet the needs of the ministry here. As you know, the road will be developed in front of us, and that I went and addressed the city council concerning that is going to be $500,000 for us, which is a huge bill. And yet the Lord is starting to work in providing big amounts for that project as well. So continue to pray and continue to give. We know that we cannot gather all of this money through tuition or even through the offerings at our church. We need people to provide for these needs by giving, and we trust that the Lord will continue to bring the other benefactors here and help us with the work that we're doing here. I'm not ashamed to ask for money, especially when it's for something that goes to such a good cause as this. And so we trust that the Lord will continue to provide for us, but he delights in providing through you. And so we ask that you would give. We'll have the men come forward to receive our spring program offering. Let's pray together. Father, how thankful we are for the school here, and the physical plant needs a lot of work, and we need a lot of help. And we pray for the road development, the property development. We ask that you continue to provide for us. We ask, Father, that you would help us to take care of what we have, but to recognize, too, that there are times when we have to work really hard to make sure that we renovate things and make them look nice. And we pray that you provide through the parents, but through other resources that we have as well. We look to you, Lord, to help us and to give us the wisdom that we need. We cannot do anything apart from you, not anything that will last. And so, Lord, unless you build the house, we labor in vain to build it. And we pray that you would build it in and through us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. 45:1-3.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Praise Him, all you servants of the Lord.
You who stand in the house of the Lord.
In the courts of the house of our God.
Praise the Lord, for the Lord is good.
Sing praises to His name, for it is pleasant.
Jesus the crucified.
So trust in my arm and to thy care.
I know thou lovest me.
I'll do thy will, the heart sincere.
I'll be what you want me to be.
I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord.
Over mountain or plain or sea.
I'll say what you want me to say, dear Lord.
I'll be what you want me to be.
Here am I, Lord, send me.
Matthew 5:13-15.
You are the salt of the earth.
But if the salt loses its flavor,
how shall it be seasoned?
It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men.
You are the light of the world.
A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden.
Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket,
but on a lampstand.
And it gives light to all who are in the house.
Let your light so shine before men,
that they may see your good works,
and glorify your Father in heaven.
January 2nd, 1956, was the day that 29-year-old Jim Elliot had waited for most of his life. He jumped out of bed, dressed as quickly as he could, and got ready for the short flight over the Ecuador jungle. Almost 3 years of jungle ministry and many hours of planning and praying had led Jim to this day. Within hours, and he and four other missionaries would be setting up camp in the territory of the dangerous and uncivilized Indian tribe known as the Akas, known now as the Wadoni. The Akas had killed all outsiders ever caught in their area. Even though it was dangerous, Jim Elliot had no doubt God wanted him to tell the Akas about Jesus.
As a little boy growing up in Portland, Oregon, Jim Elliot listened carefully as visiting missionaries told about life on faraway mission fields. He asked them questions and dreamed about being a missionary himself someday. It made him sad that so many people in other countries died without knowing about God.
On February 2, 1952, Jim Elliot waved goodbye to his parents and boarded a ship for the 18-day trip from San Pedro, California to Quito, Ecuador, South America.
He and his missionary partner, Pete Fleming, first spent a year in Quito learning to speak Spanish. Then they moved to Shandia, a small Quechua Indian village, to take the place of the retiring missionary. Jim and Pete studied hard to learn the language and fit in. Their hard work paid off. In 6 months, both were speaking Spanish well enough to move to Shandia. When they arrived in Shandia, they also had to learn the speech of the Quechuas.
3 years later, many Quechuas had become faithful Christians. Jim now began to feel it was time to tell the Akas about Jesus.
The Akas had killed many Quechuas. They had also killed several workers at an oil company drilling site near their territory. The oil company closed the site because everyone was afraid to work there. Jim knew the only way to stop the Akas from killing was to tell them about Jesus. Jim and the four other Ecuador missionaries began to plan a way to show the Akas they were friendly.
Nate Saint, a missionary supply pilot, came up with a way to lower a bucket filled with supplies to people on the ground while flying above them. He thought this would be a perfect way to win the trust of the Akas without putting anyone in danger. They began dropping gifts to the Akas. They also used an amplifier to speak out friendly Aka phrases. After many months, the Akas even set a gift back up in the bucket to the plane. Jim and the other missionaries felt the time had come to meet the Akas face to face.
One day, while flying over Aka territory, Nate Sate spotted a beach that looked long enough to land the plane on. He planned to land there, and the men would build a treehouse to stay safe in until friendly contact could be made.
The missionaries were flown in one by one and dropped off on the Aka beach. Nate Saint then flew over the Aka village and called for the Akas to come to the beach. After 4 days, an Aka man and two women appeared. It was not easy for them to understand each other, since the missionaries only knew a few Aka phrases. They shared a meal with them, and Nate took the man up for a flight in the plane. The missionaries tried to show sincere friendship and asked them to bring others next time.
For the next 2 days, the missionaries waited for other Akas to return. Finally, on day 6, two Aka women walked out of the jungle. Jim and Pete excitedly jumped in the river and waded over to them. As they got closer, these women did not appear friendly. Jim and Pete almost immediately heard a terrifying cry behind them. As they turned, they saw a group of Aka warriors with their spears raised, ready to throw. Within seconds, the Aka warriors threw their spears, killing all the missionaries: Ed McCauley, Roger Udarian, Nate Saint, Pete Fleming, and Jim Elliott.
Late in the afternoon of Sunday, January 8th, Elizabeth Elliott, Jim's wife, waited by the two-way radio to hear Nate Saint and his wife discuss how things had gone that day, but there was no call. As evening turned to night, the wives grew worried. They knew the news was not good.
The next morning, another missionary pilot flew over the beach to look for the men. He saw only the badly damaged plane on the beach. News quickly spread around the world about the five missing missionaries. A United States search team went to the beach, found the missionaries' bodies, and buried them.
Operation Aka didn't end there. In less than 2 years, Elizabeth Elliott, her daughter Valerie, and Rachel Saint were able to move to the Aka village. Many Akas became Christian and have become a friendly tribe. Missionaries including Nate Saint's son and his family also lived among the Akas.
Matthew 16:24-26. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me.
For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it.
For what is a man profited if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul?"
Lord, help me use my fleeting. Thank you. In Romans chapter 12 and verse 1, which is the theme of our program, Paul writes, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. The big difficulty that we face in Christian churches today, not only here at Heritage Baptist, but in all churches, is that there is a disconnect between doctrinal teaching and practical application of the Scripture. In other words, everyone is fine as long as the pastor or the Sunday school teacher or whoever doesn't go beyond teaching the Scriptures. If he teaches the Scripture and then applies the Scripture, then he's gone too far. The moment application is made, that is the moment that everyone feels that they have the freedom to take it or leave it. Now, the fruit of the Holy Spirit, we talk about that in Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. The fruit of the Holy Spirit comes from the root of God's Word. And so if we don't have that root from God's Word and then also the fruit bearing in the Christian life, then you have to wonder if it's a Christian life at all. There can be no application of the Scripture that is true without sound teaching. You have to have sound teaching of God's Word. But the converse is true as well. That is, if we have scriptural teaching without good application of the Scripture, then that is not what the Lord wants either. That is foreign to Scripture. Once we learn what God desires, the Bible's admonition is that we act upon it. Romans 12 and verse 1 is a central command, present your bodies. And the idea of a Christian presenting his or her body as a sacrifice to God is simply the idea of presenting your whole life to God, continually upon the altar, recognizing that if I'm going to be a Christian, I'm going to need to practice self-denial. And so our devotion to service really is, in fact, our devotion to God himself. And God desires that each of his children accomplish his will for his glory. So it all begins with accomplishing the will of God. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. It is God's will that you offer your bodies a sacrifice. Now, Jesus Christ, of course, is the only full and satisfying sacrifice for sin. None of us can sacrifice and think to ourselves, well, you know, I've been able to pay some of my sin back today. I've given it the biggie. I have lived for Christ. Okay, that's not how the Christian life works. As a matter of fact, the Christian life begins when we understand that there isn't anything that I can sacrifice in order to merit heaven. That Christ has sacrificed for me, and I trust in his sacrifice. But after I realize that, after I turn to Christ and put my trust in him, then I am to present myself a living sacrifice. As a matter of fact, if I don't do that, then the Christian life that I claim that is within me is suspect. As a matter of fact, God wants us to continue to come to him and sacrifice our lives to him so that he can set us apart in order to demonstrate the righteousness that Christ has given us for the glory of God. That is his will. That is something that he desires that we do. And so the means of sacrifice, you know, the way that we move and live and have our very existence in this life comes from yielding ourselves to God, depending upon his Holy Spirit to bear fruit in and through us. And by the way, God will bring us greater peace as we set our lives apart for him more and more in the days ahead. I am bothered, I'm sure that some of you are as well, by what we are seeing happening in Christian circles around us. We don't really have people that say, okay, I'm going to give my whole body, soul, and spirit to God so that I can be totally used by him. Instead, we have people that are reserved and people that are keeping back parts of their lives, and they want to live those aspects or maybe certain compartments of their lives in a way that doesn't please God, and then come to church on Sunday and say that they're worshiping God. But as far as the Christian life is concerned, it's all or nothing. You move forward in your Christian walk with Christ, or you move backwards. And anything apart from devoting yourself totally to Christ is something that is not the normal Christian life. I don't think that people understand that too much. Only the Christian, and the Christian alone, is able to refuse sin in his or her life. Did you know that? Nobody else can. You say, well, I quit smoking, you know, without Jesus, and I stopped doing bad things without Jesus, and you know, and there's a lot going on there. It's you that is doing it. And you know, you can let go of certain habits, but others come rushing in. And you can be pretty proud of the fact that you've been able to discipline your life. And you can even look down at others with a certain amount of self-righteousness, saying, look at what I have done. But really, the only thing that counts is what Christ has done in and through us. Only the Christian can resist the seductive whispers of sin in any format that they come. And so it's important for us to realize that. Only the Christian is able to present himself before the Lord as a living sacrifice. Now think about that. And I think that that is God's will for us. And we're to do that for the glory of God. It says in Philippians 2, verse 17, yes, and if I am being poured out as a drink offering on the sacrifice and service of your faith, I am glad and rejoice for you all. For the same reason, you be glad and rejoice with me. Now, I am pretty sure that God will probably not call most of us to martyrdom here in our assembly tonight. We have just listened to the story of Jim Elliot, and Jim Elliot and those missionaries that were with him that day magnified Christ. Now, what does it mean to magnify? It's just for certain people. Means to make. It's for all Christians. And the word holy, the idea of being holy, means to be set apart. God wants to set you apart in order to demonstrate the righteousness that he's given to you at salvation, and he wants you to do that for the glory of God. That's what holiness is all about. You know, the Bible commands us, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1. We are to perfect holiness as Christians in the fear of God. Now remember, Paul is speaking that command to the church at Corinth. This is a church that had incest going on inside of it. This is a church that had very, very strong sexual immorality and idolatry that were a part of it. And they needed to make sure that they cleansed themselves from all of that filthiness and that they perfected holiness in the fear of God. The Corinthian church was very much like what we see happening in California. People have decided that they will live their own brand of Christianity, but we need to get back to what the Bible teaches. That's what will make us happy. That's what will bring us joy. No Christian is absolutely holy in this life. None of us. Now, we realize that. But we don't use it as an excuse to stop growing in holiness. We're always moving forward in our relationship with God. The Bible puts it this way, we're moving from one glorious manifestation of God in our lives to another, and then to another, and then to another, from glory to glory to glory, until Jesus returns or until we're done here on earth and we go home to be with our Lord. And so it's important that we realize that this alone is a rational way to live. This is your reasonable sacrifice. Anything else is irrational. This is the normal Christian life, to be sold out for Christ and to be unashamed of the gospel of Christ. And yet in our world today, we have too many people that are not being the salt and the light that they need to be. Equally true, God is not pleased with those who just grin and bear it in the Christian life. There are people that are always willing to do their duty and to get in there and to pitch in. And yeah, I'm going to be there every time the doors are open. But they are really hypocrites. They have deluded themselves with self-righteousness. They think that by their well-doing, that God is going to be somehow more pleased with them than he is than with the person that is living a very licentious, sinful life. But you know, if you're self-righteous and you just do these things out of a sense of duty, or if you're just living a very sinful, wicked life, both could end in the same destiny. There's people that stand up and rear their heads in judgment of people that are doing wickedly, but they are doing the same things. The Bible has a strong condemnation for those kinds of people, calls those people hypocrites. And so we need to make sure that we're not hypocritical when it comes to our relationship with the Lord. We are to grow in true holiness, not just in some form of self-righteousness. God doesn't owe us anything as Christians, but we certainly owe him everything. We owe him our very lives. I beseech you then, just as Paul would beseech you, I beseech you by the mercies of God, because great are those mercies through God's Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And think about how reasonable and how profitable and how pleasing it is to God when you present your bodies to him, when you present your lives to him. Isn't it time for Christians to start living an eternal quality of life? Isn't that what God wants us to do right now in the present? God wants us to be salt and light. He wants us to turn from doctrinal theory to practical service. And so God wants you to give your lives as a sacrifice for him. That's what we teach the children, unabashedly. And yet they need examples. If we cannot reach the family, then we really cannot reach the children effectively. It is our responsibility as adult Christians to be sacrificial. When you suffer for doing that which is right, when you suffer shame for his name, then you bring glory to God. And you are a partaker of the very sufferings that Christ suffered. And that there can be nothing more satisfying in the Christian life than that. That's what Jim Elliot, Nate Saint, and all of these missionaries understood. I'm hopeful that that's what some of us will understand, and that we will give our lives to Christ. No matter where we're going to church, that we'll give our lives to Christ. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the great joy that it is to be a part of the Christian school here in Antioch, and to be a pastor. What a privilege it is to teach and preach the Word of God. But Lord, it is really a time that we're facing here today where we need Christians to rise up and to be serious about their Christian walk. And I'm afraid that many Christians are just really scratching the surface. We ought to be spending large amounts of time internalizing your word, memorizing it, making it a very part of the fiber of our very being. And then so often we have good intentions and we go home and we fill our minds with recreation and with entertainment that this world energizes. Lord, we want more of you, not more of the world. We ask that you would help us to live lives that are rational lives and not irrational. Help us to realize that the normal Christian life isn't what we see around us. The normal Christian life is pursuing holiness for the glory of God and measuring ourselves up against Christ and finding that we always fall short, but we're always striving for more. Lord, we press forward. We reach forward. We want more. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for coming this evening, and I hope that you'll stay around for some fellowship afterward. And we have, as you go out the doors to your left, the kids will be in the classrooms, but you can find the refreshments there as well. You're dismissed. Thank you.